introduction. Thank you all for being here. We'll talk about the work that you've done on droplets that fall on surfaces. So the problem itself is very simple. We have a flat surface, a droplet of water or ink or whatever falls on it. And this work was quite controversial. So initially we had an argument about the authorship. What should be the order of authors? So nobody wanted to be first. So we had to take a vote.
I want to be first on this article.
We took a vote. Ebert got two votes. I got one vote. And he became the first author. It's a very controversial topic, and we got very interesting comments from the reviewers. I'm even going to put them up. Although I'm in no way opposed to humor or being funny, I would also like to see the authors eliminate what are definitely out of place, flippant, and humorous comments from the final manuscript.
What were your comments?
That was the first comment.
But what were your comments then?
The funny thing is, I'm going to come back to that. The first paragraph of the paper is plain awful. While the present authors do not cite a single useful reference in the opening paragraph, they then cause further damage by citing a popular song and a fan used reference to allopathic medicine. And the song was, "Raindrops falling on my head." I truly cannot sing, but that was one of the funny things. Citation to "Raindrops keep falling on my head." We are citing allopathic medicine, but there was something also very funny that we're in Dutch. We define something called a Krang number. Find it later. But you know you are in good shape when you get comments like this. Because they didn't criticize the work itself, they only criticize
the style.
So the solution was simple, just deleted the whole paragraph. The first paragraph we deleted altogether, half of the funny comments were gone.
But I thought, let's be first author because it will be rejected anyway, so then problem solved, and everyone accepted.
Yeah, that's right. We remove the first paragraph, problem solved, and we remove a few funny things, and then it went through. Falling drops have a lot of applications, especially in agriculture. So before I became a mathematician, I was a farmer. So during the production, produce grapes, potatoes, onions, all sorts of stuff. So you have to pass insecticides to the plants. So the drops would hit the leaf and mostly fall off. And there was a lot of waste of the product. But recently the problem has been solved. Like my dad just adds a tiny little bit of polymeric solution into a big tank. And when the droplet falls on the leaf, it spreads rather than falling off. So that's one of the interesting applications. But the experimental work for this work was done for inkjet printing. So a drop of ink falls on the paper and spreads, and you want to have good spreading. And that's why they did all this research. There's also spray painting, for example, can spray paint and it has to be homogeneous. And recently people are talking about hydrophobic surfaces, developing surfaces in which a drop would fall but not wet it. That would be interesting for cleaning surfaces and other things. So most of the experiment I'm going to show here was done in Twente by the group of Professor Moser. And basically they have two cameras. They look at how the droplet impacts on the surface from the side, and there they can get the position and the speed of the droplet. And from downside they shine a laser, a colorful laser, and they can see fringes. So they're able to measure what is the film thickness between the droplet and the surface when it impacts.
But you need to explain when the droplet falls. There's a thin layer of air trapped in between. Then they are interested in how big is this
thickness, the air layer.
The thickness of that layer.
Yeah, I'm going to explain this in the next slide. The drop falls, these are time evolution. This is the position, this is the actual drop falling. There's air in between, the surface is here. It's a time evolution sequence, so when the drop falls, there is a pressure build up in the center. And when the pressure is large enough, it inverts the curvature. And this thing progresses, and then the impact is not going to be at the center, but at some rim. And there is going to be some tiny little region, a tiny little bubble that forms. You want this drop to spread nicely, but a tiny little bubble would form between the drop and the surface. And if this volume of air is too large, then it can cause problems with your printing. So most of this work is based on a concept that we call H dimple, the moment where the curvature changes from positive to negative. So this is the height that we call it H dimple. And Evert, in the last century, defined an analytical solution that the dimple goes like the capillary, the square root of the capillary number. The capillary number is simply the viscosity of air or the viscosity of the liquid of the inside times the velocity of approach divided by the surface tension. So based on these results, if you approach faster and faster, the deformation becomes larger and larger. But then came the experiments with impacting droplets. So here we are plotting HD, this height, over a wide range of speeds. So you can see the Stokes as a speed, the speed of approach. And the way they did the experiment, you put a syringe very close, you release a drop, and it falls very slowly. You increase the height, it will go faster, higher and higher. And the student went on for weeks and weeks and weeks doing experiments. They did hundreds of them, varying the approach speed by about 4 orders of magnitude. So eventually, if you are high enough, it would reach what's a constant speed, so it will no longer rise. And this is about here. But the interesting thing is that, okay, initially at low speeds, the velocity, the deformation rises with speed as expected. But for very high speeds, it didn't. The deformation went down. So they say that, oh, there is a capillary regime and an inertial regime. And then they went on to do all sorts of theories, they published in physical review letters. So that was a fantastic experimental work. But then they came up with the answer toward the end of the paper, what is the moment where it turns over? And the answer looked like this. Viscosity to the power 1 over 7, surface tension to the power 3 over 7, density to the power 4 over 7, and radius to the power 4 over 7. And Evert didn't like this answer too much. It looks Thursday afternoon that we went to the talk in NTU. I came back, I point and click all the dots, and then half an hour later, Evert came back with a formula.
I think they've forgotten one term. You've got it, right?
Yeah, I'll show it. Yeah. So, we have done a lot of work on this problem. What is the deformation of the function of height? And we compare it with our result. This 0.4, it was calculated numerically. The square root of capillary is a scaling analysis. And then, okay, you increase the velocity, the deformation should increase. And everything that we did before this, agree with that. Even we have points up here for bubbles. But it turned out that for droplets, it does not obey this scaling law. So a drop falling on a surface is fundamentally different than a bubble impacting on a surface in air. So you think that, okay, if you're doing fluid dynamics, that a bubble impacting on a surface in air, in water, and a drop of water impacting on a surface in air would be the inside out of the problems, like it should be the same equations. But it's only true for very small velocities. For large velocity, there has been an inertial term, and that was the contribution of our work. So this is the major contribution. A drop or a bubble have an internal pressure, which is surface tension times the curvature. If you have a bubble, if you are on top or in the bottom, the pressure inside the bubble is the same. It will be constant inside the bubble. But for the drop, it's different. When the drop impacts, this point doesn't move anymore. But all the liquid that is inside the drop would keep pushing forward. So that's the basic concept. If you have the bubble, there's nothing inside it to push forward. The liquid, all the liquid on top is pushing down. And it generates an extra pressure of the form rho v squared.
Up, you're saying that there's a pressure gradient in the drop because of the inertial term?
It's coming, yeah. It's, the back is still coming in with v. Well, here it's already stopped. So you get a stagnation pressure, half rho v squared at the bottom.
No, just before impact, just before impact. Like, help me understand here.
Oh, yeah. Before
so just
impact,
before impact, the pressure inside the bubble is uniform.
Uniform.
And it is without that, with the inertial term.
It's just to sigma over r. Before impact.
Before impact, yeah.
Once this part fills the wall and stops, then
it must be zero there, so you get a stagnation pressure building up.
It's like the liquid that's inside. It's moving with velocity v, but people that are in front are no longer moving. So there is an extra pressure there. That's the main result that we have added here. So basically, when you write down the equations, so the pressure being sigma times the curvature has an extra term, rho v squared. And then we also have a drainage equation. I've shown this equation many times. This comes from the Navier-Stokes equations. It gives a drainage between two in the lubrication limit. So from this equation, the HDT is basically V. We look at only at the parameters. We have H cube. We have divided by R squared. So H cube divided by R goes like square root of HR. So we have the V looks like this, times P, there is a P here. So when we put that P inside here, we get this result. So without the factor of 2, we isolate H over R from this equation, we get square root of capillary number. With that extra factor of rho V squared, we have square root of capillary number divided by 1 plus the Weber number, which is given by this. Rho R V squared divided by surface tension. So this is the answer. Basically, the deformation goes like this term. It's very, very simple. And does it work? For the factor 0.4 was obtained numerically.
Hey, just go back a little bit. Yeah, I'm asking a really stupid question. So that even one more term, one more thing before. Even before impact. So this a static water droplet, for instance, has those two terms that I understand, the top that you're writing. P zero plus the surface tension term that is divided by the radius of curvature.
Yeah, correct. Right.
So, but even before impact, if I ask this droplet that is coming in that has got a uniform G force acting on it.
Yeah, all over the drop.
So that doesn't contribute anything to the pressure there?
In the article we have included the gravity term, but it turns out it's less than 10%.
Okay, so I'm not wrong. So there is another gravity term that is acting there.
For simplicity, we deleted it.
There is actually another term here.
It's OGH.
Rho G.
Rho GH, yeah, yeah.
Rho GH here, I deleted for the talk to make it simple.
Okay, so that's okay. So that's fine.
So there is
so
a Rho GH
term is small, you're saying that you're being
less than 10% of the effect.
Okay.
This is the most important concept of the the paper, so which allows us to solve it. So the scaling for the pressure has an extra rho v squared in it.
So if you don't have that rho v squared, then
yeah, of course, you won't get that correction term in the denominator there.
The paper number will just be zero.
Yeah, without the correction term, we get back the 0.4 square root of capillary that we had before.
You have a correction term.
So the correction term gives this equation. And then, okay, let's compare this equation with the experimental data. So, and it gives a red curve. Absolutely beautiful. And the moment where it turns around is simply Weber equal 1. Simple as that.
Instead of that formula with 4 to the power of 4, I think it's 7.
So you can just eliminate, this will be 1. So V is just the square root of sigma divided by the rho in R. So it's a much simpler result for the position where it turns over. We actually put the limiting cases. So if you go that way, you have the square root of capillary. If you come this way, you get the minus the square root of the Stokes number. And that's where the controversy comes. So it's well known for people that know it that this slope should be Stokes to the minus 2/3. It's been on the literature for a few years already. Everybody says it's Stokes to the minus 2/3. But our results show that it's actually Stokes to the minus 1/2. And that's the controversial part. So Stokes to the minus 1/2 would give this limiting curve. Stokes to the minus 2/3 will give this limiting curve. And they both look pretty good compared to the experiment. It's not really crucial. But this was derived from theoretical principles, where the other one had some cumbersome analysis to get the Stokes to the minus 2/3 out. But a lot of people did experiments, and they all say that, OK, it looks good to the minus 2/3. And we were the first in the literature to say that, okay, maybe it's minus 1/2. And then maybe 3 or 4 months ago, Stéphane Zaleski came from France. He does full-scale numeric simulations of impacting droplets. And then we took him for coffee downstairs. Yeah, I'll finish in 2 minutes. We took him for coffee downstairs, drinking coffee, and then okay, let's show him something. Oh, we have done this work with impacting droplets, and the answer we get is the Stokes to the minus 1/2. And he was like, and then he showed his numerical simulations. Yeah, I also get Stokes to the minus 1/2. But he was trying all sorts of ways to justify. He asked the student to go back and do all the simulations over and over again, and he got Stokes to the minus 1/2 as this slope numerically. And he was very pleased, so he immediately added our article to his presentation he gave the next day in NTU, and he's about to publish something with the same results. And this is my last.